Yo, welcome to it. It's the Morning After Podcast with me, Chef Stuga. And today I have a special guest. The only Olympic medalist, silver. And he's got like 9 gold medals. I'm right, I got 9.
I lost count.
He's lost count. He's got like 9 gold medals. He's got like 2 bronze. We won't count those. Doesn't matter. The young champion, Nijel Amos. Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh my God, it's Nijel Amos.
It's in the house.
It's Randis. It's Tobar runs this house or whatever.
Randis, so chef.
My guy, the ultra. How you feeling?
Feeling good. It's been good times being back home. Even though it's not the normal world you could be into now, coming back home, having good things going on.
Yeah.
Not be extra careful each and every step you take, you know, this and up then live life. But it's been a great time.
Okay. Yeah. Let's start from the beginning, Nijel. How did all of this start? Like, kind of let's go Marobela. So how did you go from Marobela to 2012 Golandani and winning? Like, how did the journey start?
Just wanted to get one guy out of my back, you know. When I was in senior school in Makonnen, I was a football player. I still have 33 games, 29 goals as a striker. So you can play your mates and tell me how you're taking on one, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm making a brand football. I feel like I was better in that sport. But you know, as a football, it's 11 guys.
Mm-hmm.
Different motivation level.
How shy?
Yeah, no, different impact in terms of putting the work and want to win that goal.
Yeah.
Because, you know, which is, we all have different motivation. Okay, fine. Now, my situation I had back home.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to get out of there. I wanted to get my family out of there.
You
so
want to
make it better for my family. So, you know, I can be. To be the best footballer I could be, but if 11 guys or 10 guys in the field doesn't come put the motivation different, all motivated but different back home when you left.
No, we are being motivated. And what inspired him? And the fact that he wanted to get his family out of that situation.
When I get to senior school, I was admitted as a football player. I think senior school was like, oh no, this guy will be good for the football team. So when I get down there, this guy, our athletics team, the coach keeps on seeing me corridors. Hey, man, join my athletics team. I won the national the past year, but I was just doing it because I had a bet with my cousin, you know?
So wait. Yeah. So before you actually join...
Before I actually joined McConnell,
You had won the national...
The national 5,000, which is 12 runs, and the national 15.
And you did that because you had a bet.
I had a bet with my cousin.
With your cousin. No,
the thing was like, but it's stupid if you look at it because he was a sprinter, he was a 100 runner. Then I was doing 12 runs, so we're comparing two different things that can't come together, you know?
And you won that bet.
I won that. We have nearly the house competition. I won. I bet everyone. I was nominated. Certain regions. So regional schools. You get to the national level. The national level, I won the national titles that year. And then I came here and represented Botswana and the COSASA, the something like COSASA, Southern Youth.
What year was that?
In 2011, you know.
Oh, 2011. Yeah. Because 2011 you did it,
yeah.
And then you didn't qualify. And then 2012, you got the silver medal.
So 2012, yeah. So I came in, so I'm just fresh out of senior school.
Yeah. You were what, 19?
18. I was 17 by then.
17.
I was 17 then, and I came out of the school. I was 17.
Yeah.
So the deal was that, okay, this guy, the athletic coach, keeps on saying, join the team. One day, I was just like, you know what? I just want to have a free life in the corridors.
Yeah.
Let me just show this guy.
Hey, because why would I like this?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then little did I know that's where my life path was lying. I'm still on that journey today. And it took me, I took my family out of where I wanted to take.
So let's talk about 2012.
Yeah.
How was it? That morning, the training, to getting to the finish line?
I think for me, 2012 was just started when a year before 2012, which means I feel like I spoke my life into existence.
Yeah.
The start of 2011.
Yeah.
I knew that next year is the World Junior Championship, you know, and I think I can be one. I can qualify for the World Junior. And then I had this post on my Facebook. I said next year I'll be in Barcelona making my country proud. You know, I posted that in 2011. I was thinking about it. The next year is the World Junior. That year it happened. I crossed the line, winning the country first World Junior gold medal. You know, and that time is like 2012 Olympics are 3 weeks after that. So now it's like, actually, I've achieved the goal of my day, but Olympics, I'm going to see all the superstars, I'm going to enjoy the food. For me, it was all about, going to London, but going to enjoy the food, going to see all these people.
And you were 19 at that time?
I was 18 that time. I was 18
when you crossed that finish line.
When I get to there.
2012,
I was 18, so I was like still just new into the floor, still a junior, not touching senior level, you know, because for athletics there's junior and senior level.
Yeah.
So from 19 you're turning to be a senior level, from 19 to, so I'm still in a junior level. I just won the world junior. I won the world, I'm the world best in my own league, in my own age meet now. I'm good.
800
yeah.
meters.
Yeah, I'm the world best now in my age group, which is all under 18. I'm good. So I got the championship record, so I don't have to fight about anything at the Olympics. I just go in there to enjoy the floor and just cross the line and one line after one line and one line.
So with that medal, does it come with money?
No.
It didn't come with money.
It's not money. The Olympics is
when did you start getting money?
The Olympics don't win money when you cross the line. The Olympics, yeah. Look at it, the vision of the Olympics to bring the whole world together, the same sport. It's the only sporting event where you have the whole world sporting together, which is football,
every sport.
So it's all about bringing the whole world. So you don't win money, that kind of peace and humanity kind of way. That's how I look at it. As we make money when you win the world champion, that's when you win the money. So it's too different.
Can you explain one thing? I remember we spoke about the situation where you won your first gold medal, right? I remember you explained to us that day, yeah, you were racing with Amanda, right?
Yeah.
And that day, I think the Minister of Sports was shocked.
Yeah, so what happens, like, you know, I just came out of senior school, I'm only 18. No one thought I would qualify for the Olympic. There's 0.0505% chances of an 18-year-old to win Olympic medal. And coming from Botswana country, there's no chance.
Okay.
Because it was after 54 years my country been trying to get that.
Yeah.
And then I came in. So look at my country population and the chances of someone becoming actually an Olympic medalist.
Yeah.
We were not on the table for that.
No, the chances are
amazing. And I was very slim chances that could happen for me. So that time, the country been investing, Amanda, she was in high performance center at Kodvo. So they knew that Amanda is going to win a medal.
Yeah.
So it was a project.
No, trust to Aene, convince to Amore.
I was still new in the scene. I just came into the scene. There's no one knew about me.
Yeah.
No one knew about me. No one knew about me that I had that potential anything could happen. So that time, all the potential that's like they knew Amanda's gonna get the medal. The minister was around there, and then oh shit, it spilled out like that probably. So the minister was in there.
Hey, the minister was out here.
So
drinking water.
So the minister was after Amante's final, the minister knew that, okay, fine, we didn't get our goal as well with the country.
So,
you know, so he was in the flight next day, flying back.
So he flew back when you were...
When I was racing, the minister was in the flight. Probably he knew about that one when he landed, you know. So yeah, so because they knew that probably he was in first class in jail.
So he got on the plane.
I don't think they anticipated that I'll go to the final. So the plane was already booked, ticket already.
Snap, so they already booked his ticket.
I know, even though this is the day that the final will be happening, probably there's no chances Nigel will be in the race.
So the minister didn't believe in you, your country probably didn't even know about you.
I was an underdog, you know, no one knew about me, even the racist guy that I was.
What about
underdog.
What about your family?
I think guys who knew about me was my coach and my family, because but that time my family didn't understand what I was doing, so I didn't think they understood what could really happen, even though we didn't have a television at home, they had to go and watch it. The neighbors about it, we mean winning that medal.
They had to go watch it at the neighbors.
They had to go watch it at the neighbors, so
yeah.
You know, it was so for them, it was, they didn't understand really what was happening to it. They knew, okay, this guy came on top of it, but really on top of what's really going on there, what we are talking about and the level of it. So when I get down there, man, I get to the line, I knew, okay, fine, I won my heat, my same final, I was number 2, but it was 0.3 second deep, I'm into the final.
At that time, what's going through your head?
I knew that I've achieved my goal, I got into the Olympic, I've lined up in the line, I've won, so for me it was like, oh, you're in the final now, that's bonus, just get in the race and God works makes in a miraculous way, you know? So when I did the warm-up, the world record by then, first time ever talked to me, Rudisha. He came at the warm-up, when I was doing the warm-up, coming to me and be like, my son, my boy, my little boy, my little brother, I'm going to go hard, save your energy.
That's what he said to you.
Yeah, so this guy, we never spoke. He knew that I'm second fastest in the world behind him that time, that year. He had 143.10, I had 143.11. Just 1 second, I'm right there, and I've been doing well, I came into my heat, my final, I'm there. But he came to me and said, I think for that time it was the brotherhood, the humanity of the sports and everything comes in to say, you know, this is a young boy, especially coming from Africa, it's my brothers, they are rising to this game.
Yeah.
And then just told me and the other guy who was my second position from the world junior, because now I'm facing the guy who was second position from the world junior, 3 weeks now we're facing a different stage. He says, yo, little brothers, butter your bread nicely. Now I'm going to go hard. And then we really did
what,
butter our
what
bread,
did you say to him when he said that to you?
I never said anything.
You didn't say, you stayed focused?
No, I said, all right, okay, this, it's for me, it's like, okay, this guy, what does he tell me, God? But I didn't think much about things at the time. I knew that, okay, this is the day which is going to get on the line. I was there picking it in the line, you see, I was doing everything next. Because what happens, like, when I was walking down to the core, something just came so bad on my body and I threw up. I remember Coach OT asking me, are you okay? What about you?
So
like,
you got sick.
Like the bell's been called, 800 meters, man, to the Nijel Amos, last call.
When
I'm walking, no, I'm walking down to the coach, he's talking about the last prep of the race, you know, they're walking down, they were okay, let's go. So I get in that land, and then I throw up, and then from there, I was just in this zone, I can't explain, I was free, man, I was
you're in a different zone, it was a higher level.
It was a higher level of energy, man, but I was really like getting there in that race, I was free. As soon as the race started, I was just didn't care that I'm in the Olympic final, I just, the vibe was on, like, no, just go
the energy was correct. The energy was correct.
Synchronizing it.
So, okay, fine, besides all of that, what other opportunities has running given you? Because you are a Nike ambassador.
Yeah.
I get it.
Yeah, then for me,
currently.
For me, mostly gave the little boy who was in the farm, see aeroplane hit. I don't really see the chance to be in that aeroplane and get to see other side of the world and see other things have been done and land across the world. I think for me, that would be the best thing ever. It took me out from where I am, it took my family, and really managed to build me as a person too, you know, because you got to see yourself, you sit around the table, like my team now, I'm the world number one. So it's like, to be the world number one, what does it take? You need to have the best addition, you need to have the best physio, you need to have the best coach, you need to have the best psychologist. And for me to sit around the table and see all these people and understand that that success is based on me, understand what you do in the board game in a different level of it, knows that at this stage people they depend to see that success on me. This dietitian works every day to make sure that I get my diet right. This psychologist works every day to make sure
you get your mind right.
You know, this coach is putting on work, and this is just making sure that I don't get broken, you know. So you look at all those things that came together. That's what Nike gave me, that opportunity. The ambassador of Nike, they took me, they gave me the opportunity.
Yeah.
You should remember that I only lost to the world record holder that Olympics, but we raced 8 times. I won 7 times. So statistics 7-1.
So you've got the numbers on the board. You've got good numbers.
Our statistics is 7-1, me world record holder. And then he was from Adidas, and this is Nike. So I was the second guy in the world best. So Nike had our, and that's how I started to go with them.
Can I ask something? Honestly, do you feel like all these numbers are shocking to us? Because do you feel like people here
celebrate
are ignorant? Or you feel like just our country doesn't appreciate? Because I remember, you know how we met. I mean, the way Sana Waka, I mean, Kalanga people have been winning for the longest time. Like we said, 2028, we're taking the country, right? So they should be ready. So the other thing I want to ask is, like, but wono bangeno, iba to ba basinga talokanye kana. Iba to elu tawoto zogo. Achievement or your achievement means a lot.
I think. People don't understand what I've achieved to the sport world, to the sporting whole world thing of it.
Yeah.
You know, this time I did is the third fastest ever time.
Oh, that's
it. So it's the third fastest time ever. It used to be a world record. It's a former world record.
So you've set a world record.
So just, the guy broke the world record, but this used to be a former world record. And when the guy who did this world record in the past, Sebastian Cole, when he did it, he was knighted by the Queen, Sir Seb Cole.
So he
in
was
the House of Chambers.
When I did it in 90.
You see, so I think they don't understand. It's looking at the sport in such a way, now you commercialize it. You help it to raise the country.
Yeah, yeah.
And look at you, say, no, if they do something like that, they knight this guy, they put him
so our government
in the House of Chambers. It's different governance that you're having.
Yeah, our government should have recognized you more, celebrated you more. Your numbers are crazy.
I think for us, it's for structures that in policy that are in place to be changed when you look at sports and arts and everything in a different kind of way. It's not a commercialized in Botswana.
Are you looking at commercializing it? Like if you retire from running, like, are you going to get
looking
to that
at fighting
place?
To open that opportunity. Frankly, I'm the managers that I met around the world. I'm trying to learn from them. I've been with the same manager for about 10 years now of my career. So it's for me learning and building a relationship that I could use to after I'm done. So I'll show my loyalty to the guy.
Yeah.
You know, this guy be with me. No matter what's winning, was down, he never left me. You know.
So retirement from actually running is close.
It's very close, my man. I don't want to be hard when I'm out. So I don't want to be pushed out.
So where are you based currently? Because I understand you have to go to the States in a couple of days now.
Yeah, I'm based in the States. I've been based there for 4 years now. They've been my 50th year. with Nike there, because there's a group which is the best middle distance group in the world. What Nike did is, okay, let's bring the middle distance guy, let's
and put them
put
in
them
one
together.
Place.
I know, if a guy like me, they get down there, they find a guy who helped me to my training, if I need something like that, someone faster on me.
So now you you're living with people who live the same way you live. There's no family, girlfriend, your daughter is back here at home. How do you cope?
It's something that I lost my childhood already. You know, if you look at it, I never had a childhood life.
10 years.
After I won that Olympic medal, 18 years, 19 years, I have to move to South Africa. I'm just a farm boy. Instead of moving to Gaborone, to East Cape Town cities, even going to a different country, to people who doesn't speak English, not so on, and speak Afrikaans.
So
you're explaining now that you had to learn English on the way, on the go.
On the go, my man. I learned a lot of it on the way. I mean, I remember one time my first plane has this girl sitting next to. So I know how to stop and say. I don't want to do that again when I be like, oh no, but you tell me like you left, you know?
And when you're in SA, because you was in Potchefstroom, we used to see on Facebook that you're even driving a BMW Z3.
Yeah, man, that was my first car.
That was your first car?
That's my first car. I mean, I just won the Olympic medal, people in general, they gave me money.
Like, that's when you did the KFC
video? Yeah, that's when I did the KFC video.
What KFC video was it?
There's a KFC video when I remember he was trying to speak English, and I don't know what he was saying. He was driving in his car.
Yeah.
He was saying, oh, this crusher is like it was not pronounced.
Ah.
He didn't care. You know what I liked about him is the fact that till this day
he's still himself.
You know,
he's still himself. I think that's the great part, and that's what makes him amazing. I wish I was like that. If I won a medal, I don't think I'd be as humble as you.
Yeah, so. You see, as I said, one thing you understand as people is the power of teamwork, you know? From the 2012 race, there's no one who's racing now from the Olympic race that I was lining. I'm the only guy still standing.
Oh, for real?
Yeah.
And you're like what? Now you're like 26.
Yeah, I'm 26. That's my prime in our sports. Last year, 2019, I did the fastest time in the world ever since 2012. So last year, 2019, I did my second fastest time 8 years after. So you see what happens, that I bounced back, I was on top of the world, and then I had dance were going because I didn't have the structure around me to stay where I have to be, where I am at the top of the world. So when I went back to the US in 2017, I remember I sat down the coach in 2017, asked me, what do you want? I said, I just want to get back to the top and stay. You know, he said, what the top you want to stay? I said, I want to win championship, I want to be the fastest guy in the world again. He said, okay, this is a 4 year span. So gonna start 2017, you're gonna run 143. I did that. 2018, you're gonna run 142. I did that. 2019, sit down, Nigel, this is the year. You say you wanna run 141 this year? I said yes. You say you should know that there's no human being who ever did that twice in so many years apart.
Yeah.
There's no human being from 2012 the race you're racing, there's no one ever been faster than like that. You wanna take your body to where it never been. So yeah, I wanna try it out. You say, okay. This is structure, commit to it. I had to commit to the plan. I had to sacrifice a lot of things, change my lifestyle to switch into the plan. And then 2019, we go to Monaco. I remember the day very well. I was in a good mood. You see, the days I do well, I wake up in a good mood.
What put you in
a good mood? It's just the day I wake up, I feel like I'm into this. You know, like I take time, I put in my mind. Like now we have trained.
Listening to music?
I listen to myself. I listen to my own thoughts. I don't listen to music when training. So
championship.
Even I get down there to training now, I picture myself winning Olympic medal. In Tokyo,
champion.
Crossing that line, you know. So for me, 2019, you get to Monaco. He says, I remember he didn't come with me to that race in Monaco. I went with one of my teammates and our physio. So I get down there. That morning, I wake up and I'm sleeping with my teammate. He says, he woke up in the morning. It's like, he calls me faggot. That's how boys call it. Like, faggot, it's the day today. I'm gonna give it out.
Yeah.
You know, wake up, I'm like, that's the day today. I'm gonna try it out, my man. And then that day, after breakfast, I walked into a Ferrari dealership, you know. And then I say hello.
So you went to a Ferrari dealership before you went for the race?
This was in the evening. So the morning I walked into a Ferrari dealership, I just felt like I would say hello to this guy. Say hi. I say, no, I just want to tell you that I'll be back when I got my money, you know. And then I left. I still have that video somewhere. I posted it somewhere. So that evening, and then I did something that is nasty. I got to 141, fastest time in the world in 7 years after. So that's one thing a lot of people understand. That in 2019, I did fastest time in 7 years, first time of a challenge.
Yeah.
It's a divisible game that is being played. And unfortunately, the world
can
have
something. Do you feel like is it annoying to be in the situation that you are right now? Like, we're shocked with all these achievements that you've made, and best believe, like, none of us know anything about all these records that you're saying.
Yeah.
we're not being educated enough about, because we read a lot about Michael Jordan, we read a lot about Borussia, we read a lot about other people, but locally we have you that has break, you've broken every single record that you can possibly do, and I feel like people out there more appreciate you more than we do. Do you feel like the sports facility here don't teach, because you're the person that kids should be learning from?
Yeah, definitely.
Especially when it comes to sports.
Well, not even kids, even us.
Yeah.
Like, how we have such an individual.
We're already fucked. What the?
Nah, there's a little chance for us. I have
never too late.
Yeah, it's never too late. The champion is saying it's never too late. So
I'm still gonna learn from Cook, actually, man. So yeah, be using him. I'm protecting him because I need to be helping teaching.
Yeah, you see, so I'm gonna be chef. I can try and run. I can try.
You get marathon in. Then get some marathon in for sure. You know, 2-3 marathon.
Yeah.
So yeah, your question was like, do you think people really understand the thing? I don't think people understand the sport and understand really the details of it.
Yeah.
It's, there's something, if you can know something from Tawatawa, but you can't know the details of it.
Yeah.
It's different, you know. You see, you can work for 1 second for 10 years of your life in sport. You see, that's some people don't understand for that. We're working to get back to 1 foot 2, and it took us 7 years to do that.
Yeah.
You see, it took a lot of teamwork, a lot of tears for that to happen. I think people doesn't understand it, doesn't understand the records and what we achieved to the world.
Yeah.
But again, I look at it and say, it helps. Because now it gives me, someone like me, a room for me to just go on my journey.
Yeah.
And doesn't have really much on what I'm about and be knowing that I'm into the next step. This is the journey. For me, it's a journey. No. So if they look, most of the guys I meet, they say, yo, you have 6-1 Olympic medal, never won anything. I'll be like, if this guy that I know that I've been the world fastest guy for all past 7 years, this is the thing that for the past 7 years of my life, as either world number one or world number two, I never lost that spot.
Yeah.
You see? So I'll be like, this guy doesn't really understand the stats of the world. You know, you didn't see me win the African medal, but who's the world number one when it comes to ranking? You know, yeah.
Nah, that's completely understandable. So what's next for Nijel? What are you venturing in? You had security company, there was DJ Zorro. What's going on with all these things?
What
are those still things? Are these still happening?
What happened to DJ Zorro?
You see, DJ Zorro was born in the time when I was, you see, I started 2013, I got injured. I had a career threatening injury. So that time I was worried about when am I going to run again, when I ever be on the line again. That year was the year I should be running my first world championship. I just won Olympic medal in 2012. This year I'm coming back, this should be my time. And the world was waiting all my time. That time the world record holder was not at the games too. So I was watching these games, the guys that won 800 was Armani, won it 144. And then I look at my tattoo, I'm like, I'm a 141 runner. You know, I could run that time. It woke me up, I could do it. I should have been there. I should have gotten my chance to fight for the world Olympic medal.
Yeah.
So in that moment I realized, no, Nijel, now you're not only destroying yourself physically, mentally, you're destroying yourself too.
Yeah.
So that's when it takes to be a DJ. It was a way of me getting into the world and connecting with the world in a certain way and just take it easy on myself.
People don't know this. Like, there's this event that you used to do at Marabella.
Yeah.
Like, you're one person who has tried to give back.
With the Nijel Amos Foundation.
With the Nijel Amos Foundation. There's also the event, Jacob Marabella. Yeah. People don't know that most of that event is, you were putting in money, you're not making profit.
I never had a sponsor. I never had a single sponsor for that event.
I remember.
So it was more for the community.
It was
and
more
building.
For the community thing.
And a lineup of, you know where we come from? And people that said never see these events that happen this side. So here it is now, someone who's that young and who is a national treasure or tribal treasure for us to be investing so much money that he's working so hard for to bring all this entertainment. Best believe this guy was not making money, but he was making sure.
It was a community outreach type situation.
So don't you feel like you doing that?
We need to get him a statue. Anyway, I think man, Nijel, it's been great talking to you. He's a great inspiration. I'm still trying to take it in. Yo, the numbers are crazy. I think we need to celebrate him more as Botswana. Celebrate the Nintendo Facebook and all of that. No. We need to remember people like Nijel Amos and start calling him both champ hand. Because all he's about DJ Zorro and all of that. I appreciate you coming out, my guy. I know you're about to fly out. The Olympics are this year, right?
This year July, my man.
This year July, what should we expect?
Now Kalanga boy will be in Tokyo.
The Kalanga boy will be in Tokyo.
So Kala,
okay.
So Kala, take you, as you said, it's a It's a year for us, you know. I said I'm preparing ourselves, you know. We say I come from tribe of pioneers. I come from tribe of hard workers. You know? It's something that we have it. We see it everywhere in industry in our country.
Yeah.
We might not be the one running on top, but we're the one making real structures and every weekend, you know.
Yeah,
we're the one really pioneering everything, you know.
Yeah.
So we say we got it good from our grandfathers, you know. So we're keeping our grandfather's spirit going and everything.
Yeah, no, that's beautiful. That's beautiful.
So what are you guys doing to prepare for the Olympics? I understand you guys on camp.
Yeah, we're on camp now, but for me, I tried as much to spend time with my national team here, spend time with my team back in the US. Because as much as sports is the one athletics, I need to have a team relationship with my team. I need to go, when I go to the championship, I need to be able to interact with them. At that time, I need my mind to be easy. So this year, we decided, my coach, like, no, it's too cold that time, January, February. So let me just spend that time back in Botswana and train with the guys and just interact with them, make the relationship with the guys too. Because at the end of the day, make relationship with people too down here. Because at the end of the day, I'm coming back home. I have to always keep in touch with them and just let them in touch all the time. So yeah, I'm heading down back and join my team in Flagstaff. We're going to 7,000 feet up altitude, so no oxygen that much. Staying there for 3 weeks, put on the work before you come down here so that lungs can pump on and put on the work. So it's a whole structure, it's a whole everything that goes in for you to see me on the line at the Olympics. It's crazy.
And are you looking to get married anytime soon?
Definitely, I'm looking to get married. It's prayers, man. I come from a big family.
You're gonna get married here, or you're gonna get married somewhere outside.
Whatever, find that the thing.
So you haven't found someone.
I think I'm in the right place.
Okay.
I'm in the right place with that. So yeah. You know, it's just now, just to believe. Yeah.
Now, one thing is to invite the golden. I'm gonna cater again.
Yeah, chef, my man.
Chef. Yeah, of course. Yeah, no, but Nijel, for real, thank you for coming out, my guy. Guys, we're about to wrap it up. Nijel has to go do some championship stuff. This episode was powered by Jin Lu. Shout out to Jin Lu. Make sure to get it. It's like $350, $400 a pop. And then they have the little nippy nippy 50 ml. It's like $50. I get 50 bull.
Yeah,
it's locally, you know, locally produced. It's beautiful. I love it. It's a mashup. Anyway, shout out for Peter's Place, the location, it's in phase 4, Peter's Cafe, for the food earlier. Peter's Cafe, it's also located in phase 4, right behind Pure Drop. Other than that, I think that's a wrap from me, myself, Stuga.